My name is Laura Boren, and I serve as the Vice President for Student Affairs at Northeastern, and I am very honored to be a part of this program, and I want to thank you for attending tonight. I think we are in for a very, transformational experience. At this time, I would like to introduce our President of Northeastern State, Dr. Steve Turner, to say a few words.
Thank you, Dr. Boren. Good evening and welcome, everyone. Let me honestly thank you for being here. This really is a transformational evening, and it is in two ways. One, because of the honoree, and secondly, because of the speaker. These are two men that have truly changed different parts of the world. But before I say a little bit about Larry Adair, let me recognize, I recognized upstairs in another meeting members of the cabinet, but I want to recognize our student government president and part of the Student Government Association. Thomas Teague is here. Thomas, I don't know who Taylor's here. Would you stand and be recognized? I appreciate our student leadership tonight. Yeah, these are your student thank you. We have, as beyond the cabinet, we have what I call the Executive Council, which includes the president of the student government, the staff council, faculty council, athletic director, and it's critical that as we sit down and address the real tough issues in higher ed, and budgets are always a tough issue, that we have an audience and we have the voice of our students. So Thomas, Matt, those of you that are helping us, it only gets more difficult from here between now and the end of the session, right, Mr. Speaker? And I appreciate our student leadership and certainly Dr. Boren's leadership there. Tonight we're here really as part of the Larry Adair Lectureship Series. This is an event that's gone on since 2004. And it's really about three things. One would be a willingness, one would be service, and the other would be leadership. You know, sometimes the difference between somebody that's really a leader and someone that's not is willingness. And more often than not, that's what separates. So first we have someone that's really home, Larry Adair, a 1969 graduate, who's here tonight with his sweetheart that he married as he was a servant, as a veteran. I believe they married in Hawaii. High school, right? Were you high school sweet or college? Okay, we're not gonna talk about the high school sweetheart. But if you've heard what I just said, that first we have a man that served in the military, then we have a man that served in public education, then we have a man that served District 86, then we have a man that served the state of Oklahoma from 2001 to 2004 as the Oklahoma Speaker of the House. And so the difference is, yes, he's a servant, but then he was also willing. You know, there are a lot of folks, he was willing to put his name and take some risks. He put his name on a ballot. And if you've never lost, there's risk, isn't there, Speaker? But on the other hand, the risk is worth. And the last thing that I would mention, that what this is about, is the leadership that he provided. And he continues to provide. Speaker Adair serves on my advisory council, and NSU's the fourth largest public institution in Oklahoma, but there's no substitute for bringing people like Speaker Adair in and letting them tell me what's going on and what they think and what they're hearing and what we should be doing. So he continues to give. So tonight, I want to recognize and ask him to stand, and his lovely wife, Jan, to stand, former Speaker of the House, Larry Adair, and his wife, Jan. they have certainly other guests, family, and friends here. For the sake of time, I just say welcome, all of you, and thank you for being here. And let me conclude my remarks, and then I believe, Dr. Bourne, you're coming back. From an example of someone that's just like you, I ask you tonight, are you willing to make a difference? There's some risk. Are you willing to provide the leadership that it takes if you accept that risk? And I think that you need to make this personal about you. You really need to say, what can I do? And tonight, the other piece of this is that I assure you, the speaker, who will come in just a moment, our speaker of the evening, who will come in a moment, will also challenge you to do the same things. And it's what you do when sometimes everyone's looking, but sometimes when no one's looking, that makes the difference. So, Speaker Adair, thank you. Dr. Bourne, please come. Welcome, everybody.
Thinking about people who make a difference on this campus and provide leadership, Peggy Glenn, NSU's Director of Development and Executive Director of the NSU Foundation, is going to come forward and introduce our speaker. Without her vision, we wouldn't be here tonight for this event. So, Peggy.
Thanks, Dr. Bourne. Well, my name is Peggy Glenn. I was a student here sitting, not in these seats because they didn't exist, 20-something years ago, and hearing some just incredible speakers that changed my life. And for those of you who are students in the audience, I want to tell you how we got this speaker tonight, because I think it may change the way you look at your college experience. When I was a freshman through senior, I was a member of the Model United Nations group here on campus, and we traveled to different conferences, Norman, Oklahoma, that was a big thrill for everybody, and then St. Louis, Missouri, we went every year, and then we also got to go to Montreal and New York and Washington, D.C., but it was at the conference in St. Louis that I met a couple named Brian and Carrie Endless, and they were from Chicago. And he was one of the leaders of the conference the last 2 years I went. We struck up a friendship, which continued after my graduation from NSU when I moved to DC. Visited him over the years in Chicago multiple times. He visited when I lived in Dallas. And he is the senior policy advisor for the Hotel Rwanda Rusesabagina Foundation. And I called him and said, hey, what are the chances that we could get Paul to come speak to us? And he said, well, let's talk. And here we are. So I want to tell you, those of you who are students, when you meet other college students, please remember that the person you're meeting may be your next employer, or may be the person who helps you out when you most need it. And I think our speaker tonight actually exemplifies the importance of connections. Well, I'm actually here doing the introduction because I've spent some time practicing the pronunciation of his name. It's Paul. Now, it took this Okie a few times to not say Paul and make it two syllables. I've condensed it down to one. It's Paul. Now, his last name's so much easier. It's Rusesabagina. Say it with me. Rusesabagina. Now you know, and you can tell someone on the street who you heard tonight. And it means warrior who disperses the enemy. Now, the interesting thing about Rwanda is that you don't get your father's last name. It is chosen for you. It reflects you. Rusesabagina, warrior who disperses the enemy. Well, if you've seen Hotel Rwanda, you know that it's the story of a Hutu man who was left in charge of a luxury hotel in Kigali during the brutal massacre of over 800,000 people. That's more than twice the population of the city of Tulsa dead. And that happened in about 100 days. Now, Paul is married to a Tutsi woman, and he sheltered 1,268 Rwandans during the bloodshed, securing protection and supplies for them until they could be evacuated safely beyond the line of fighting. He now spends his time in both Belgium and the United States. He runs the Hotel Rwanda Rusesabagina Foundation. And I wanted to show you a clip from their website. If we could run that.
Hello, this is Paul Rusesabagina from the Hotel Rwanda Rusesabagina Foundation. You might know me through the movie Hotel Rwanda that was made about my life since during the genocide of 1994. I've been speaking out as the voice of the voiceless, advocating and raising awareness about what is happening in Rwanda today, and also talking about the conflict minerals in the Congo. We hope that you are going to join our team through this form.
Now, the address for the foundation is on the bookmark that you received when you arrived, and I hope you'll visit it and like the foundation's page on Facebook and sign up to receive updates on what's happening in Rwanda and beyond, because we truly are global citizens. And one of the missions of NSU is to empower socially responsible global citizens, and that's what we're here to do tonight. Well, here to tell his story firsthand is the recipient of the U.S. Presidential Medal of Freedom, and I want you to say it with me, Paul Rusesabagina. Paul.
Thank you, Peggy.
Thank you. My pleasure.
Thank you. Wow. After so many good and beautiful words, what can I say? I thought that I was going to introduce myself to Cherokees because I'm one of them, but from far away. I heard today that also names are given to people by their parents, and each and every name has a meaning. So are we in Rwanda. I'm not coming back to that. I'm going straight to the point. I'm going to tell you a few of my experiences. If we had the whole night, I would tell you a little bit more. But now I'm telling, just summarizing. Let me first of all tell you who we are. In Rwanda, we are three ethnic groups. They are Hutus and Tutsis. Hutus are the majority, 85%, and Tutsis, 14%, and 1% of the Pygmies or Batwa, who are not actually the real Pygmies, but it is just another kind of. So till 1959, the country was led by a clan of Tutsis through the king. In 1959, through the Hutu Revolution, Rwanda became an independent country and, so to speak, a democracy. So when, through the revolution, the many Tutsis who actually lost power because Hutus were taking over, Tutsis who lost power end up going to exile. So these are the ones who were held in camps, in refugee camps, for approximately 35 years. In the meantime, their own children, who were being born in camps, growing up in camps, without schools, without food, without shelter, without clean water, with nothing, they having no choice, they joined what was then called Eastern and Southern Africa liberation movements. Then by 1979, they overthrew one of the most known dictators of the world, who was then Idi Amin Dada, who died a few years ago, I think in 2005, in Saudi Arabia. By 1986, briefly, they brought power. Today's Ugandan president, Yoweri Museveni. So they had become experienced army guys, soldiers. And by 1990, October 1st, Rwanda was attacked by those former refugees who had now climbed the ladder in the military sector branch, and there were some of them even generals. This war was the beginning of a kind of mass massacres, not only in Rwanda, because it extended to the Congo. Until 1993, early 1994, we were seeing something going to happen. We were seeing what was going to happen in Rwanda as a mother seeing a car going to hit her kid. And instead of doing something, you could see her closing eyes so not to see. This is what was happening in Rwanda, 1993, early 1994. I will never forget throughout my whole life, April 6, 1994. On April 6, that evening, I was celebrating with my brother-in-law, Thomas. His name was Thomas, and his wife was Fidence. Those are their names. So we were celebrating. We were celebrating two things. Fidence, the wife, had just finished her degree in the university, and as a young mother who was 26 years old with two babies, she had also got a job in a company, in a Dutch company, selling cars. And I had helped them to get that job, so they invited me for a dinner. But fortunately, my wife Tatiana, who could not join us, she finished her work a little bit late and went straight home. She heard the missiles. It was around 8:30 in the evening when she heard a huge noise, a noise of two missiles hitting the presidential plane, which was landing at the airport. And we used to live very close to the airport. So she immediately took the phone, called me and said, "Listen, Paul, I have heard something. I have heard something I have never heard throughout my whole life. Now rush and come back home." Instead of her joining us to the hotel, and we were used to that, because in 1993, in December, or in November, we fled our house because we were in danger. As I was telling you, we saw the genocide coming, but we did not know what it was supposed to be. So there were militias and also infiltrated rebels were just coming to our house, breaking windows, throwing in what are grenades in rooms, and killing each and everyone in the house. So we had left our house before, and then we went to live in the hotel. But that time, when we had just come from Europe, we came from Europe on March 31st, 1994, it was a Thursday morning. Without any idea of what was going to happen the following Wednesday, it just in 6 days. So we said, now the United Nations are here. That we do have 2,700 UN soldiers. Why should we go back to the hotel since these people have brought peace? We did not really know what was their real mission. Their real mission, they were not peacemakers. They were not the peacekeepers. They were observers. who would come, watch people killing each other, and then draft a report, send a cable to New York, and say, okay, we have seen those guys butchering each other, but we did not know this. That time we went to our house, and this is where Tatiana called me from when she heard the missiles. I will never forget Thomas, Fidens, and myself leaving our meals, our drinks, everything, standing up and walking through the hotel hall, main hall, joining the parking, going and getting into our cars. As a tradition, they were younger than me, and now according to our tradition, young people always have to accompany, to escort the elders. They escorted me to my car, and then before I opened my car, I stood there and just hugged every one of them and told them that, listen, you guys, go home. I will see you tomorrow. But unfortunately, tomorrow never came because they went their way, were killed, both of them, and never found. But fortunately, as you saw in the movie, for those who saw the movie, we happened to have their two babies. And I is the elder one who was 2 years old, and Karine, her sister. Today, those two girls are our daughters. And Aiz is a sophomore in Georgetown University in Washington, and her sister Karine is in Northwestern University in Chicago. This was the beginning of an endless mass massacre throughout the whole country of Rwanda, and also throughout the whole region. Then, that time I went home, I arrived at my house. By the time I was just crossing the gate, the phone was ringing. It was the Micolin general manager, because me, I was no more the manager of the Micolin hotel. I had been transferred to a sister hotel, the Diplomat Hotel. I just came back to the Micolin only on April 12th to help the refugees. So the real Micolin, who was a Dutch, the real Micolin manager, who was a Dutch, is the one, he was calling me. And I just rushed and went and picked up the phone. And he told me that, listen, Paul, your president has been killed. Come back to town. I was about maybe 6-7 miles away from from downtown. That time, I tried to call all the UN. I had a lot of connections. All the UN generals, all the Rwandan army people, everybody, the last UN guys I called. I remember a major from Bangladesh. I called him and he asked me, does your house have two exits? I said, of course, it does. And he told me, if they come into one door, you go out through the other one. The message was clear. The United Nations had failed to stop what was happening. The following morning, many of my neighbors, this is sometimes why I say that each and every human being might be a potential killer. This is always why I say that each and everyone can be like a shark at the bottom of a sea and come up and break the boats. So many of my neighbors were in military uniforms. Many others in militia uniforms, with guns, with the traditional weapons, anything you can think of. I not realized that I was almost the only one in the neighborhood who did not have any training, no uniform. So that was that was surprised, but this was going to continue. But fortunately, many of my neighbors, about 26 of them, started fleeing to my house. I always asked myself, why did they flee to my house? And I have never found any answer. At the end of the day, we had 26 strangers, neighbors in the house who had come to seek a kind of asylum. Now you can imagine you are with those people. You know outside there, you are actually hearing the gun shooting. You are hearing what is going on all around you. So what do you do? And you see people are coming to you, getting increasing in numbers every hour, every day. And you don't have food for them. It went on like that until April 9th at noon, when I was standing in the living, in my living, with one of my guests, an old man called Michelle, who was standing with me. And we saw, many other refugees were back in rooms. So we saw soldiers climbing the gate. And when we saw these guys climbing the gate, Michelle, now shaking, he started telling me that, listen, Paul, these guys know I'm in your house. They want to kill me. Before they come in, kill all of these people, you see, let me go so that they see me and kill me and feel satisfied. I looked at him and said that, Michelle, these guys are not looking for you. They are looking for me. This is my house. Let me go and meet them. In the meantime, people in the rooms now were just trying to get out by all means, but those soldiers had already surrounded the house. I went towards a young captain who was leading the team of 20 soldiers, and I started to open up a dialogue. Throughout my whole life, I always believe that words are the best and the worst weapons in a human being's arsenal. This is my belief. Then I approached this young man who actually did not want to talk, but I just wanted to open up a window of dialogue. And I told him that, sir, why did you climb? Because we saw them climbing the gate. Why did you climb? Why didn't you ring? I would have come and opened for you. I knew my bell was not working because for 3 days there was no electricity. I knew that. But I had to open up a dialogue. And then he looked at me and said, are you the manager of the Diplomat Hotel? I said, yes. If you are the manager, then a new government has been set up. They have sent us to come and pick you up, bring you to the hotel, because this government has decided to take over your hotel, and we need you. I do not know why, but before I left the hotel that night, the three days before, I had taken the seller's keys, the store's keys, into my office and locked them into the office. So when they came to my hotel, they had no supplies, no food, nothing. So they needed me. They came to pick me up. This is one of my experiences, the worst ever. And then when he said that he has come for me, I told him that, my friend, I have my family. And in the family, we used to be 2 parents, 4 children, and 2 housemates, 8 people. By that time, with that day, we were 34 people in the house. So you can imagine such a family. Then he was so nice. He seemed to be so cool. The American way, as you say, the American language. And he said to me, take everyone, it's okay. Then we started now piling people into our cars, and we drove. a mile away, not at the hotel compound, as you see in Hotel Rwanda, just a mile away, on a street of Kigali, where you could see a lot of dead bodies. Some of them had started decomposition. And they were very familiar to us. We had been living in that neighborhood for 7 years. So we saw a lot of dead bodies, some of them missing their heads, mutilated. And I saw the Jeep, which was ahead of us, slowing down, pulling to the side of the road. And also I was given orders to pull to the side of the road. I saw these guys who were so nice, who were so cool. I saw them jumping out of the Jeeps, and each and every one his gun on my head. This young captain came to me and said, "Listen, you traitor, you are lucky. You are lucky we are not going to kill you today because we need you. But have this gun, kill all of your cockroaches in these cars." Dehumanizing people before killing them. I knew that guy was not joking, according to what I could see along the road. Then, once again, I just looked at him for about 5 minutes, speechless. After 5 minutes, I told him that my friend, myself, I do not know how to use guns. And I was very sincere. I did not know how to use guns. Not at all. I didn't know anything. But even if I knew, I did not see any good reason why I would have killed. I just pointed out that old man who was previously standing in the living with me. I said, "I don't see any good reason to kill this old man. Why?" There was a young lady, Grace, holding her 3-month-old daughter, and she was also sitting in the car with her baby. And I just pointed out that baby once again and said, "Are you sure?" Told them, "Are you sure, my friends, that this baby is your enemy today? Are you sure that this baby is my enemy?" But sometimes when we have to deal with such people, we have to come down to their ground and then talk. And then now, I told them that, "Listen, you guys, I do understand you. You guys are hungry. You guys are thirsty. You guys are tired. You are stressed by this war. But we can find other solutions to these problems." This is when we started once again negotiating, dealing. After two long hours, not a minute or two as people see on the screen, after 2 long hours, we came up with an agreement, and I always believe in agreements than judgments. So we came up with an agreement, and they drove us up to the hotel. That day, the 9th of April 1994, I had come across eyes in eyes with the devil, with evil. And we had dealt, and we had come up with a compromise, which was actually not a compromise, but it was, in a way, one. So that day, I had learned one of the most important lessons, which was going to help me throughout the whole genocide. And even today, I had learned how to deal with those guys. So now I go to the hotel. The hotel is now occupied by the government for another 3 days. And then just in the morning of April 12th, when I just got up in the morning very early at 6, I used to tour the whole house, the whole building, see what is going on. And now I see the members of the government gathering everything, running down south, leaving the hotel. That morning, that is when I took my car. I drove my children and wife, and we went up to the Mikolin Hotel, which was a hotel of the same company. And I remember we turned left and got into that place. This is the place where we were going to spend 76 days. There is a kind of what would be called an island of peace, because that what you see on the screen, we call it an island of peace in a sea of fire. The whole country was a sea of fire. Arrived in that place, the Dutch manager had just left the previous evening, and when he left, he took the hotel keys and threw them to the hotel receptionists, and everybody was rushing. That you can never grasp that kind of moment, what was going on during the whole 3 months. Then the receptionists went to the cellars, went to the stores, got the best wine, the best champagne, the best food, and started celebrating. Now I'm here. These guys are no more my employees. I had left that place in 1992. Now I am coming to impose myself as their manager. This became another trouble. And we had 400 refugees who needed food. You can never have provision for 400 people for a week. So now there is no security all around the hotel. And militias had already put up a roadblock at the entrance of the hotel, preventing people from getting in and others from getting out. That day, I just took my black binder, what I called my black binder, and I started calling people, calling all the generals I knew in the country, asking them for help, to give me security for the hotel, to get the roadblock removed. And at the end of the day, I had five gendarmes, who came and stayed there until the end, and the roadblock was removed. But now, try to be the manager of such a place. The number of people or the people inside is increasing each and every hour, each and every day. You don't have electricity. You don't have running water in the rooms. You don't have food. You have to smuggle each and everything in details in order to survive. And all of those people in the rooms, they can't even show up. They are hiding, kind of. So I started now cooking outside, rationing the swimming pool water. I would never forget that precious water of the swimming pool, which was so precious and more important than gold and diamonds, because that time, gold and diamonds meant nothing, zero. So I started going down myself. Each and every morning at 8:30, I would just go down and watch the people coming with the dustbins from the hotel rooms to get a few drops for the day. In the evening, at 5, everybody was coming down to get a little bit of water for the night. You can imagine how life became. Life became so complicated. And the hotel was attacked each and every time. I remember, for example, on April 23rd, I had gone to sleep very late. I had spent my night and my day and night phoning, sending faxes, calling the international community, the White House, the State Department, the Peace Corps, the EU, the European Union, calling Brussels, disturbing each and every person I knew. So that night I went to sleep at 4, and I was woken up at 6, once again guns on my head, with orders to get each and everyone outside up. When I got that order, I started charming, telling them that, listen, you guys, you know that these people who are here are refugees. I tell them to leave, yes, I'm willing to, but where are they going? Who is taking them? How? They looked at me and said, you tell those cockroaches to go as they came. Now the message, I told them, that, listen, my friends, your message is decoded. I do understand now. I had understood that these guys wanted to kill these people. And once again started negotiating, jumped out of my bed, negotiating, dealing. And we negotiated. I asked them to give me 30 minutes to get ready myself with my family and then get everybody out and close the hotel. This is what they were telling me. But it took me more than 30 minutes to get 30 minutes. Then at that time, when I got my 30 minutes, I went to the roof of the hotel to see what was going on all around us. Mikolin Hotel actually is a building like any other buildings in the West. You can see it more or less like Paris or Washington or New York. So, but the building you see on the screen used to be a hospital in South Africa, which was actually abandoned and then renovated for Hotel Rwanda. That was it. So now, I went to the roof and looked all around us. All around us, there were militias in militia uniforms, with the spears, with the knives, with the guns, with each and every weapon you can think of, and also jeeps surrounding the hotel, and also soldiers. When, for the first time in my life, I lost hope and said to myself that, listen, Paul, this is the end of it. To me, it was almost the end of it. I remember that morning taking my phone again, and these guys were so smart enough. 6 a.m. in Kigali was 6 a.m. in Paris or Brussels. It was midnight in New York and Washington, so there was no one to call from outside. But before the end of my deadline of 30 minutes, I saw the Assistant General Chief of Staff for the police on the hotel compound. And then I said, these guys are not going to kill me. Well, that time, that day, we were saved. We were saved because we had a weapon. Of course, I had my tongue. I had some cash. I had some in my cellars. I had some drinks. Then also, I had a means to channel my message. I had a phone. But now, on the 3 days later, on the 26th in the morning, one of my guests took a hotel phone, called Radio France International, and started to describe how militias were losing, how the army was losing, and the rebels were winning. That before the end of his interview, I saw a colonel who was in charge of security of the city coming to the hotel. And from the main entrance of the hotel, he just told me, just shouted and said, listen, Paul, I have come to pick up that dog. Very bitter, very angry. I invited him to my office, made him understand that is not a job of a colonel to hunt after dogs and rabbits into the jungle. That is a small job for small guys. We discussed this for many hours, and after many hours, of course, sometimes, because we say in Rwanda that two men can never sit around a table and talk seriously without a drink. Sometimes, and a drink is not coffee or tea. It is something serious. So he left peacefully and told me that, listen, I'm not taking him, but many other guys are coming for him. I said, as long as it is not you, go in peace, we'll deal with it. Today, Thomas, that journalist, my guest, is now a journalist who is working at the Voice of America in Washington, D.C. In 2005, in October 11, if my memory is good, it used to when I was still younger. So on October 11th, I was going to get what they call Wallenberg Award by the University of Ann Arbor and the University of Michigan. And surprisingly, I had not seen him for 11 years. And surprisingly, as a surprise actually, I was still behind. And he was behind. They brought me in the audience. I was sitting there. And I saw someone coming from backstage, coming to the podium. It was Thomas, who was going to introduce me. He had a pile of papers, and I saw him. He stood there. Instead of getting out one word, I saw tears dropping into the papers. It was him. The president came, took his speech, actually, and introduced me. So this was one of the most exciting experiences. We were just now meeting after 11 years, and when we had been living together in such a kind of mess and madness, now we met in excellent circumstances, but he could not go beyond his human weaknesses. But that touched me. This one was one of the examples. But that day, my phone, my switchboard was completely switched off. I just picked up each and any phone. It was off. I moved up and down, but the phones were off. But after many hours, I remembered that in 1987, when we extended the Micoline Hotel, I was assistant general manager at that time. We also brought in a new fax line. And this fax line was the one which was not what I linked to the switchboard. This is the one which was going to be our lifeline. And from that day onwards, I started locking that door, which was our secretary's office. And it helped us until the end. We survived like that. So many obstacles. We crossed so many difficulties. Until now, June the 17th, I had been, actually, I saw the general chief of staff for the army, the national army, coming to see me. I thought, now, this guy wants to kill me. Now, he wanted me also to give him the same treatment as I had been doing to many high-ranking generals. Lucky enough, he came to my room in the evening. We talked, and I promised him to give him some drinks at the diplomat hotel the following, because I was now the overall general manager or president of the whole company. So now, Bizimungu, General Bizimungu, as you see on the screen, he came the following morning. I went to meet him at the diplomat. But before meeting him, early in the morning, I learned that militiamen were killing refugees in a neighboring church, which is called the Saint Famille or the Holy Family. So I was very much concerned. I started calling, and I saw the mayor coming to my hotel. I went to meet him, told him that I need protection. And he looked at me and said, oh no, Paul, I don't have soldiers. All of them are fighting. Policemen are protecting official buildings. That time, that day, I looked at him very, very bitter and told him that, sir, one day, all of this that we see will come to an end. Imagine if the day of the end was today, and you and I sitting at the chair before history, is this the real answer we would give, that we cannot protect human beings, but we are protecting buildings? That day he turned his back. I saw him turning his back. I remember myself standing there in dead, between dead flowers. Everything was dead outside there, without any other idea. But I just moved inside and remembered that I had an appointment with that general to give him some drinks. So I went to the diplomat. And when I was standing with him in the cellars of the diplomat hotel, I was called. I was informed that after killing 150 people in that church, militiamen were now running, coming to the Mikolin Hotel. I told him that, "General, now it is you to play. Let us go down to the Mikolin Hotel." We went to the Mikolin Hotel, and that day, General Bizimungu saved our lives once again. I will never forget him, that man, telling one of his bodyguards that, "You, sergeant, go up there. Tell all of those militiamen who are in this house that whoever will kill someone, I'm killing him. Whoever will beat someone, I'm killing him. Whoever will stay in this house for the next 5 minutes, I'll kill him." He went up and down, removed all of those guys. And that day, this man saved our lives once again. But at that day, I remember the UN executives who stayed in the country because the UN army was evacuated, with the representatives of the Rwandan government, the Rwandan army, some representatives of the rebels, took a decision. Now the decision was to evacuate each and everyone from the hotel, take them to a so-called safe place. That day, that evening, they came to me in the evening that day and told me that, "Listen, Paul, we want to evacuate each and everyone from here." And it was past 5. It was almost in the night. And I told them that, "My friends, let us learn from history. In the past, one day we tried to evacuate people. It was a late hour. And these people were almost killed, all of them. They were just beaten. And when they started shooting them, the first bullet from a militiaman killed a soldier. And they started fighting it against each other. That is how they were saved. There were now the UN guard soldiers, the few ones who had remained in the country, took those people who were beaten, badly beaten, and they started piling them into the back of the trucks and brought them back to the Mikolin. My wife, you see her on the screen. The way she was that day is not the way she came home that very day. She came home lying in the back of the truck in her blood, mixed with other people's blood. And I went to pick her up, brought her to the room where she stayed for several weeks, unable even to turn herself into the bed. So I brought them back to that experience, reminded them that this was not the best solution. And then we decided now to take everyone, to bring the UN armored cars, the Rwandan army, jeeps, and surrender the hotel until the following morning. And they accepted my point of view. Then we protected the hotel. And the following morning, each and everyone was evacuated. From the beginning to the end, Mikolin had 1,268 refugees. None of them had been beaten. None of them had been taken away. None of them had been killed. And this is why you see the movie Hotel Rwanda, which was made about me. So now have told you a few, as I said, of what I'll have before I conclude. I have told you a few in a few words, a few of my experiences. Now I'm going to give you an opportunity to ask me what you want to know. Which army?
India.
No.
No.
No. What we should know is that on April 7th in the morning, the Rwandan army was smart enough to slaughter 10 Belgian soldiers among the peacekeepers, the so-called peacekeeping force, or the UN observing force. So they killed 10 Belgian soldiers, and immediately, instead of reinforcing their peacekeepers, the UN actually initiated by Belgium the same morning of April 7, backed by the United States, the United Kingdom, the whole world decided to withdraw. And then Rwandans killed Rwandans without those people I myself call disturbing witnesses. Yeah. There is another question here.
Did the United Nations make the genocide worse?
Well, I would say yes. As I told you in my speech, before the United Nations came to Rwanda, we had fled our homes. My own example, I had been to Europe in March 1994 for almost a month with my wife and our son, Tresor, who was then 18 months old. So we had been traveling all over Europe, and we came back home on March 31st. That time, instead of going to our house, that would not mean to the hotel, as we had been living in the hotel for almost 6 months, instead of going back to the hotel, since the United Nations were there, we said, okay, the United Nations are there. Why should we bother? Let us go back to our house. And this is how we went back home. So to answer your question, the United Nations presence worsened the situation.
This may sound like a strange question, but what was your background as far as your parents' occupation and your family background?
Well, that is a private life question. But when I speak mostly in the public like this, there is no taboo. So I was born and raised in a mixed family. My mother was a Tutsi and my father was a Hutu. As you read also in my autobiography, of which we brought some copies. So my parents were from two different backgrounds. But my father was someone straightforward, who did not agree with a lot of things. A very serious gentleman. So when time came for me to get married, I married a girl I loved. And she happened to be a Tutsi girl. But me, I'm a Hutu by my father, and in Rwanda, in the Rwandan tradition, children follow their fathers. Even my son, who is actually supposed to be at least 75% of Tutsi, is a Hutu by me. So you might not understand, but that is how it is. And also, I grew up in a missionary school, in a Seventh-day Adventist church school. That is where I went for my primary studies and then for my high school. And then before going to a hotel school, I also did a degree in theology. Is that enough? There is someone here who also wants
to... This is another private life question, but because that's how we are, that's how we roll. I am curious why you choose to live in Belgium.
Oh, why did I choose to live in Belgium? Actually, when I went to exile, my Swiss friends, because I went to school to Switzerland, actually wanted me in Switzerland. But I did not want to go to Switzerland because Belgium is very close to Rwanda, then, or to Africa, than Switzerland. Belgium is the capital of the European Union. So going to Switzerland would be going back to my village. And Swiss were willing to give me a good job. But I also had another background with Belgians. Because as a general manager, I was a Rwandan working for a Belgian company. So I had been working for that company for many years, for more than 10 years anyway, as a general manager for them. And I had links. And also, as time went on, I had bought an apartment in Brussels. So Brussels was my second home. From my home in Kigali, I went to my home in Brussels when I went to exile. It was much easier than going anywhere else. There is someone here also who wanted to ask a question. I went back to Rwanda since September 6, 1996. I went back to Rwanda twice. The first time was around February 1st, 2003, when filmmakers took me back home because they wanted to make sure that the story they were bringing to the big screen was a true story. So they took me back, and we stayed in Rwanda for 15 days, filming all the Mikolin survivals, filming government officials, and we came back, well, me to Brussels and them to America, with 15 big videotapes of all of those testimonies before making the movie. Secondly, before the movie came out, Hotel Rwanda ironically came out on September 11, 2004, in Toronto Film Festival. So before this movie came out, I knew what was supposed to happen. I knew what would be the Rwandan government's reaction. So before getting the movie out, we decided to take back our children who were young when we left the country, those two young girls, our younger son, Tresor, who is more or less their age, he is between the two. So we decided to take them that time. When we left Rwanda, they were around 3 and 4 years old, and we decided to take them back when they were around 12 and 11 years old to have a look at their country, because I knew that they might not be able to go back. So in July 2000, for. We took them back, and they stayed in Rwanda for another 3 weeks. But me, I stayed 10 days, then went down south to Zambia.
Hi. Before beginning to read your book, I was reading a book written by Lombroso about the Lucifer effect and how or why good people turn bad. And in there was the genocide in Rwanda. And it described Pauline, a Tutsi woman that led her people, her community, to be raped and murdered in to a trap setting. And I was wondering if that was a survival tactic that was used often, or was it just a one-off situation?
I did not get clearly the question.
Her name was Paulina, or Pauline, and it was NYIRMUSAHUKO. Don't know how to pronounce that. I'm sorry.
Okay.
She led her community, and I think she was the daughter of BUTURE, and of the community, and she led them to basically a trap where they thought they were going to be rescued, and they weren't. They were raped and murdered, and he described, you know, the violence that took place, but there wasn't an answer behind the question as to why it happened. And I didn't know if it was a survival tactic that took place where many Tutsis maybe did this to help themselves, or if it was a one-off situation of someone that just went, you know, mad in the situation.
Actually, Tutsis could not save themselves in 1994. In 1994, the situation was so horrible. You cannot grasp what was happening during that time. An average of 10,000 people were being killed every day. In 1991, we were about 7.2 or 3 million people. And at the end, we had slaughtered between 800,000, the United Nations, and 1.1 million, according to the Rwandan government. And it is not in 100 days. It was rather in 3 months. This was between April 6th and July 4th. That is not 100 days, but just 3 months. But who was killing all of these people? There is sometimes a factor that many people do not know. During that time, Rwanda was in a civil war. And in that civil war, we had two warriors, two armies, the Tutsi rebels, who were killing Hutus on their side, and the Hutus militias, especially, killing Tutsis within the country. So both were killing. So to survive, because one is smart enough, it was not easy. Many people who survived, they were helped by their neighbors.
What made you feel so obligated to like save those people? Why didn't you just run away for your well-being?
Actually, there was no obligation. But in life, when you get involved in such situations, you even don't realize what you are risking and what you are doing. You just listen to yourself, to your conscience. I always tell young people that our conscience is the best advisor, because there is no one else who knows us as our conscience does. So I remember on May 2nd, when we had an opportunity to be evacuated, my name and my wife's name and children, we were the first on the list. And the refugees had read the list. They came to me and told me that, listen, Paul, we know you are leaving. If you are leaving, tell us so that we can go to the roof of the hotel and jump. That time, I can assure you, our main problem was not to die, but how to die. That was the problem. Because killers from both sides were torturing their victims, cutting tendons so that the victims won't run away, going to torture others, coming back and cutting hands, going back again. People were dying slowly. People were paying to be shot and killed. Our main objective was not that. So they would go to the roof of the hotel and jump. That was possible. Many people did. So they told me, I told them that, listen, my friends, I'm not leaving. That day, my conscience had told me that, listen, if you happen to leave these people and they are killed, I will never, ever set you free. You will never eat and feel satisfied. You will never drink and feel satisfied. You will never go to bed and sleep. You will never stand and speak. So I made a choice to send my beloved ones, my whole family, without any hope to see them anymore, and stay. That is why we made the decision that very night. I went back to my room, completely changed, worried because I had made a very tough decision. And when my wife and children saw me that night, they said, "What happened to you?" I said, "Nothing." Pretended, and I said nothing. But I had something in mind. Children continued playing. It was around 1 a.m., past midnight. So when children were just playing, I looked at my wife and said, "Listen, tomorrow you guys are going to be evacuated." Now I saw the children, my children, were grown-ups. I saw them turning back to me and saying, "How about you?" I said, "No." So then when you go through such experiences, you just listen to your own conscience. You don't ask any other advice, because if you ask any advice, you discuss, and then doubts come in, invite themselves. So this is how we made decisions. And I did not, anyway, I did not have any time even to sit down and think about this, because each and every minute, each and every second represented a danger. For 3 months, each and every minute represented a danger. Yes?
Thank you. It seems the citizens of Rwanda were defenseless. Were they allowed to own firearms so that they could defend themselves, or had they been outlawed?
No, unfortunately, Rwandans do not. Firearms are not democratized, if you can call it that way. Not everybody, not anyone is allowed to have it officially. Even those ones who have them, they have them as secrets.
Do you mind talking to us about the identity cards and your letter to Tony Blair?
Actually, in 1994, Rwandans and before, Rwandans had IDs. And in the IDs, it was clearly written that one is a Hutu or a Tutsi. So this was officially known. It was written in the IDs. but still the killers from both ends would kill people thinking that they are Hutus and kill them, and others would kill others thinking that they are Tutsis. Because being a Hutu or a Tutsi in the Rwandan history, at a given time, it did not mean a lot. Because the Rwandan king before 1959 would promote a Hutu. A Hutu means normally a servant. In Kinyarwanda, we say my Muhutu. It means kind of my slave. So those are social classes. So the king would demote a Tutsi who does not have cows. A cow was a sign of wealth. So anyone say there was a standard, maybe someone who had 10, a Hutu who had 10 cows, would be promoted to the higher class, the Tutsi class. And many Hutus became Tutsis like that. And many Tutsis were demoted from being Tutsis because they had no cows anymore. And this is what happened. And the chief, even the chief, like the mayor of a county, would even come and take all the cows and say, the king has given me orders to take each and everybody's cows because everything belonged to the king. And Tutsis, who owned those cows, would become Hutus. So it has, at a given time, it had no meaning.
Everyone over here?
Yes.
Okay.
How did hotel operations still prepare you for what took place?
That is also a very exciting question. Well, I think that sometimes when there are many factors that influence a person's kind of life. Your family, the school you attend, the job you do. In my hotel business, as a hotel manager, I always used to have my coffee at the counter or the bar at 10. My main objective was to see and sometimes chat with high-ranking generals, officers, business people, arms dealers, who would come for a cup of coffee in the morning. I would greet each and everyone and exchange words and talk. And in the hotel business, it is just like someone who has got maybe a shop. Whatever you sell, you are selling. I was selling services. So I think that all of those factors influenced my behavior, my work, my life.
Yes. You say that before the genocide happened, you knew for years that something bad was going to happen. Do you see anywhere else in Africa or in the world where there's a flashpoint for genocide again?
Well, I don't see anywhere it is going to happen. I rather see where it is happening. In 1996, we saw the new Rwandan army after the genocide. The Tutsi rebels took over. Because in Rwanda, there is always a winner and a loser, and Hutus lost. And as a formula, in Rwanda, once you lose, you go to exile. And once you win, you have power and the whole of it. There is nothing like sharing. So in 1996, we saw the new Rwandan army invading the Congo. that time, we said to ourselves that the Rwandan government was going to overthrow Mobutu. They did. And after overthrowing him, they didn't leave the country. And their men, whom they had helped, they even ended up killing him. A few years later, we saw the Rwandan government taking young people, young Hutu boys especially, strong ones, taking them into prisons. We had an idea that these boys maybe had participated in the genocide. They were getting into the prison by the main entrance and through the back door being taken to the Congo to work in mines for warlords. In 2008, for the first time, through a hard work from the Hotel Rwanda Rusesabagina Foundation, a UN report on December 10th, 2008, that report came out. I was with Kiri that time. Kiri is here in the audience. We were in Stockholm when this report about blood minerals came out. They had killed, raped, they had tortured babies, old people. They had raped young girls. And sometimes, in a cruel way, an indescribable way, raping young babies with shoes. So they killed all of those sick people who can't run away. And according to the UN mapping report that came out in 2010, October 1st, ironically, they are accused, today's Rwandan government is accused to have committed war crimes in the Congo, crimes against humanity. And I quote, if this examined by a credible institution, a tribunal or something like that, it would also be another genocide. No one ignores what happened and organized by Rwanda in Eastern Congo. And for this, I would like to know in the audience, if there is anyone who does not have a computer or a cell phone. So, I don't see anyone. Ah, there is one. Now, you are the only one in this audience who is not participating to the war in the Congo. The rest of all of us, in a way or another, I know we are innocent, are participating. These cell phones you see, these computers you see, are made with a metal called coltan. And coltan is coming from the Congo. Rwanda, the country, does not produce any single pound of coltan. And Rwanda is exporter number one of coltan. So, in other words, because of coltan, Rwanda is entertaining militias. You have heard of a certain Nkunda who in 2008, when the UN report came out, was relieved from the Congo because his mission was over. He had been discovered. But the Rwandan government created a new one. General Ntaganda Bosco, who is nicknamed the Terminator, who kills it and everyone. Since 1996 to date, the humanitarians, UN experts, and many others talk about more than 7 million people who have been killed in that part of the world. And these people who have been killed and who are still being killed are being killed because of where they were born. They were born on a land which contains those precious minerals. So I don't see a place only, I don't only see a place where the genocide can take place, but I'm seeing a place where it is already happening now when we are talking. It is not more than 5 days ago that General Ntaganda Bosco surrendered, crossed the border from the Congo, came back home to Rwanda because he's a Rwandan. And smart enough, because if the Rwandan president knew that Ntaganda was going to show up to the US embassy, definitely this guy was going to be killed before. So disguised, this boy went to the US embassy in Kigali, and he was sent in The Hague. If you go online, you'll see the Terminator in The Hague. So this is already happening right now when we are talking. Yes?
I've seen the movie a few times, and I was just wondering, like with the characters, and I don't know if that was their actual names, but like Gregoire and George Rutagunda, how you were able to practice so much self-control when they were, you know, when like George tells you pretty much just to ditch your wife and...
Okay. Well, you see, many of the characters, they do have their names. All their names, many of them. George Rutagunda is George Rutagunda. He was the vice president of the militias in the whole country. And George was controlling, actually was supposed to be controlling all the militias throughout the whole country. We grew up together. He was a man I knew. And I remember meeting him, it was on April 12th, at the front desk of the Mikolin Hotel. I had just arrived. And when I greeted him, very proudly, he told me that, listen, Paul, I have just buried Ismail and Tamar, his sister-in-law and their children. I looked at him and told him that, George, you seem to be proud to have buried your family members. Ismail was his cousin. You are proud to say that you have buried your cousin and their children, and wives and children. Why can't you be proud to have saved their lives? Since all of these guys who are killing are killing actually in your own name, you are the leader. Responsibility. He was supplying the Miko later on. He continued supplying the hotel with the drinks, for instance, with the Carlsberg, the Scandinavian beer, Tuborg. So with the toilet papers, he continued supplying me because he's a man I know. He went to exile in 1994, was caught in Zambia in 1996, went to the International Criminal Court, and he died about 2 years ago in prison. Gregoire is a composite character, because as I told you, when I arrived in the Mikolin Hotel back after almost 2 years, I was a kind of stranger. I was no more the manager of the house. And the way I did it, asking my bosses back in Brussels to send me a letter appointing me back to the Mikolin and getting a letter now appointing me as the general manager for all the Belgian interests in the country, because I was promoted immediately. So that is also a true story. The employees were not willing to listen to me. And as I said, they were already celebrating. I was an intruder. Those guys are drinking, they are eating, they are happy, and someone is coming to stop all of that. So Gregoire is a composite character of all of those guys.
I think we have one last question.
I actually had like two questions, if that's okay.
I said one. Go ahead.
I don't know where she is. Well, my first one was, of course, in this situation, like you said, you didn't want to leave because you felt that you had an obligation to help those people if you could. But what was kind of the driving force, the thing that kept you going while you were there, especially in the situation where you were on the roof and you looked around and you felt like it was hopeless at that point? Like, what kept you going then?
What kept me going? That is a very exciting question. And it is not one of the easiest to answer. In 1994, during the genocide, at a given time, it was so clear that the reason why those guys who were attacking the hotel every now and then, because as I said, the hotel was attacked many times, they noticed that before they killed the refugees, they had to kill me. So I was the first one on the list to die. And I knew this, and I had a network, I had everything. So I said to myself that whatever happens, I'm going to die. But before I die, let me do another small thing. I kept going like that, doing another small thing, and kind of day by day. And at the end, when I saw myself, at the end, I never realized that I was alive. So I just kept, before I die, let me do another thing. Before I die, let me do another thing. And we went on like that. I had nothing else special. I believe in one thing, I will die. At least for that, I'm sure. But when is it? We do not know. So I waited for my day, and my day did not come in 1994. And this is why I sometimes said that whatever kind of life I live since that time, is always, I call it, a bonus. Each and every day I live, it is another bonus. And this I have also been going on like that, living on my bonus since 1994. That is so gracious. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Mr. Rusesabagina. Did I say that right? I'm working on it. I can't thank you enough for coming to Tahlequah, Oklahoma, and sharing your insight and your experiences with us. You are a true role model for values-based leadership, and you've reminded me of the importance of, no matter the extreme situation, we always have the power to choose our thoughts and our actions. And thank you for being that role model for us.
Thank you.
Mr. Adair, I want to also express my appreciation for bringing us together again for this wonderful lecture leadership series. I don't know if you've noticed the crowd in this room, but we have undergraduate students, we have faculty, staff, retirees, alumni, city leaders, community members, people from Tulsa and the surrounding communities. You are a true leader to Northeastern and a change agent for us, and help us expand our mind and our thoughts and our ideas. And thank you so much for your support for Northeastern. We are fortunate to have copies of Paul's autobiography, An Ordinary Man, that's available in our lobby as soon as we're done this evening. If you'd like to purchase a copy and get an autograph, this is your chance. So with that, thank you so much for joining us this evening, and we hope to see you very soon.